Hello, I am delighted to give this WORTH Patrick Award presentation for 2020. I feel really humbled by this award and will use this opportunity to bring you through a journey on ocean acidification research. First of all, I'd like to thank warmly the nominators and the ASLO committees involved in this award. Also numerous collaborators and students, including early ones, early collaborators, I mean, Bob Bodemeyer, Steve Smith, Michel Franquignol, and Johnny Klepas from NCAR, as well as huge community efforts in this area of ocean acidification research. And of course, I'm happy to acknowledge those organizations for funding. So I will provide first a brief timeline of ocean acidification research, and then I will move into the international context, the coverage in IPCC reports and COP meetings, the gaps. I will look briefly at the ocean-based solutions and also at what is next. So really the impacts of ocean pH on organisms have started in fact quite early. Like the first paper we could find with Lina Hansson, the co-editor of this book on ocean acidification with me, is a paper by Moore in 1906 on the effects of acids and alkalis on growth of sea urchin. And you see that this paper in 1906 predates the definition of the pH scale by Sorensen, which only took place 3 years later in 1909. There were really outstanding studies published very early on. For example, this one by Gale in 1919, which looked at multiple drivers, the effects of pH and temperature on growth of a macroalgae and also germination of macroalgae. Another important paper early on, 1929, on the impacts of lower pH on commercial species, here an oyster. And finally, for these early papers, a very nice one from Rebe in 1951, which clearly demonstrated and showed that if 1% of the carbon buried in ocean sediments, the fossil carbon, will be released, then it will be change the pH of seawater tremendously to 5.9 and to 7 pH units after a reaction with calcium carbonate. So very early on, like mid 20th century, it was known that the release of fossil carbon will acidify seawater. The second period I'm looking at starts in 1966 onward, the demonstration on in the Bahamas Bank by Broker and Takahashi, and later confirmed on brief mesocosms that the concentration of carbonate could control community calcification. Subsequently, in 1998, my colleagues and I showed that aragonite saturation states controls coral calcification in the lab. And those data and others were used by Johnny Klepas to project the decline in coral calcification in the future. In 2000, this initial study on calcareous plankton by Ribesel and colleagues on coccolithophores. From 2001 onwards, ocean acidification was clearly demonstrated. It was observed on time series at, in Bermuda, in the Canary Islands, and also on the west coast of the US. And it is only in 2003, you know, many decades after the first studies of the effect of pH on the ocean, the ocean acidification expression was made popular by Caldera and Wicket. So what happened from 2003 and today? Actually, my head is spinning. Really, when you look at the development of the field, this huge increase in the number of papers per year, published per year, like more than 700 recently, and the number of authors involved in those papers, close to 2,500. There is no way that in a few minutes I can summarize ocean acidification research. The reason for this tremendous increase in knowledge, in papers and knowledge, is the fact that ocean acidification is truly a cross-cutting area, very much transdisciplinary, cutting across many fields like paleoceanography, chemistry, physiology, genetics, modeling, social sciences, economics. So the distribution of the papers is shown here. The reason that two regions stand out, Europe, first mostly because in Europe, very early on, there were large-scale projects launched. EPOCA started in 2008, and then the German bioacid program, the UK ocean acidification program, and then the METSI project, explaining this predominance of European papers. The US has been very, very active also, including through support by the Ocean and by Carbon and Biogeochemistry Program, and also by the NOAA Ocean Acidification Program. In the meantime, there was also huge progress in methods and technologies. EPOCA and US colleagues published this guide to best practices on ocean acidification research and data reporting, which has proven extremely useful for newcomers in the field. New instruments were designed for example, to measure pH in an autonomous manner, but also autonomously on Argo floats. New research platforms were used here, the mesocosms that deployed in the Arctic by Ulf Ribesel as part of the EPOCA project, by Frédéric Gazot in the METSI project, and also other kinds of platforms such as land-based mesocosms here, the setup of Sophie Dove in Brisbane, Australia. Study sites where CO2 vents are active were investigated, starting by Jason L. Spencer in Ischia, an island across Naples in Italy. And also models have become much better in terms of resolution for detecting and projecting ocean pH. The international engagement has been tremendous. It was first supported by SOLAS and INBIRD, those two projects of initially IGBP, now Future Earth. SOLAS and INBIRD established the Working Group on Ocean Acidification in 2009, and the goal of this working group was to coordinate international research efforts and help synthesize activities on ocean acidification. The SOLAS-INBIRD Ocean Acidification Working Group designed the concept of the International Ocean Acidification Coordination Center and recommended its launch to the IAEA, the International Atomic Energy Agency. And this center was launched in 2012 and took over many activities from EPOCA, namely dissemination capacity and science. The OAICC provides lots of tools and tremendous resources to the community, such as the Newstream, which publishes daily stories on ocean acidification papers, but also other kind of products. There is an ocean acidification portal for the response of biological data to ocean acidification, and also a bibliographic database that is made available through the OAICC. And the OAICC is also very much involved in training. The community also organized a successful series of meetings, the meetings of the ocean in the high CO2 world, started in 2004. It took place every 4 years with several hundred participants recently. The next one was supposed to take place this year in Peru, and it will take place in Peru still, but in 2021. We have a great program with very nice plenary talks, which will be live streamed and recorded. It's certainly an event you don't want to miss. Still on the international engagement, the Global Ocean Acidification Observing Network has been also launched in the meantime. There's a data portal. The goal is to improve understanding of ecosystem response to OA, to improve understanding of global OA conditions. And it's also providing a very nice forum for ocean acidification researchers. The UN, the IPCC, the coverage of ocean acidification in the fourth assessment report was very minimal. It has improved tremendously in the fifth assessment report, both in Working Group 1 and Working Group 2, also in the two special reports published in 2018 and 19, this one on the ocean and the cryosphere. And the community has been also very much engaged at the COP meetings, the Conference of the Parties of the UN Climate Forum. Thanks to the efforts initially of Carol Turley from PML in the UK. So the ocean acidification was very, very well represented at COP meetings. It has also its own target as part of sustainable developmental goals. Target 14.3 to reduce ocean acidification, thanks to all the work performed at COP meetings and also by the IPCC. So the research gaps, of course, there are still many remaining research gaps on coastal observations and projections, on the biological response, as illustrated here on the right-hand side, to inform properly policymakers, one needs to have information at the ecosystem scale on multiple drivers and long-term experiments, whereas most of the experiments are on single drivers, single species, and on very short timescales. Phil Boyd, as part of a SCORE working group that he is leading, has provided very nice tools for multiple driver ocean acidification research. And also there are gaps in the solution space. And because indeed ocean acidification cannot be investigated on its own, there are several climate drivers such as warming, of course, deoxygenation, and sea level rise to be taken into consideration. So when you look at thresholds, very often mentioned of plus 1.5 degrees and a decrease of 0.2 pH units, the percent area of the ocean subject to those thresholds will be 69% with high emissions and only less than 1% with low emissions. So it's really shows that the Paris Agreement accepted in 2015 has the potential to avoid the unmanageable, but one must also manage the unavoidable, showing that there is an urgent need for ambitious global mitigation and local adaptation, and the ocean provides solution for both. So as part of this exercise, the Ocean Solutions Initiative looked at ocean-based measures, don't have the time to go through all of them, and has cluster them into policy clusters, decisive, low regret, unproven, and risky. Now we tend to combine those two unproven and risky measures of ocean solutions into one concept stage, because it's a little bit threatening for policymakers to be told about unproven or risky measures. So we provided key messages at COP25 concerning solutions to mitigate ocean acidification, warming, and the impacts of climate change in general on the ocean. So we provided those key messages. So what is next? I think that there is a need to fill the disciplinary research gaps, of course. So ocean acidification research on its own is still extremely useful to understand what is happening, why some species are resistant, others not resilient or not. So that is absolutely critical. But it is equally critical to go beyond ocean acidification. We need much better projections, for example, of socio-economic impacts and adaptation measures. And also we need to look at ocean acidification, ocean-based measures holistically. I mean, cutting across disciplines, transdisciplinary view of ocean-based solutions. And perhaps other communities can learn lessons from what was done for ocean acidification. And I think, for example, at the Global Ocean Oxygen Network that is starting this year, and perhaps they can be inspired by what the community on ocean acidification has done in recent years. Once again, thank you very much to all those peoples and funding agencies. And again, thank you to the nominators and ASLO for awarding this Ralph Patrick Award. Thank you very much.